planet that you and I are going to be occupying is Jannah, inshallah ta'ala. Otherwise, the other one, also blame, you know, like a blazing ball of fire like Mars and so on, is Jahannam. So, you know, depends on whether you can take the heat or not. Terraform the earth, freely available. And the earth is such an amin, such a trustworthy element. If you place a seed in it, it empowers it to grow. If you place a treasure in it, right, it secures it. It will be entrusted. It won't steal from it. It will not be treacherous. The earth allows the saint and the sinner to walk on it. And it has such magnanimity that it allows all to utilize it for whatever reason with no cost implication whatsoever. Similarly for water. Similarly for fire, or that which gives us energy. And the primary source of energy, if we were to utilize it correctly, would be the sun. 149.6 million kilometers away from the earth, but it provides all the requirements of the energy and sun that is needed for the earth's effective function. If it was a couple of, if the earth was still at a couple of, you know, degrees here or there, or if the sun was a couple of kilometers closer, earth would not be able to survive. That's fire. But air, available all over the place. Why? You need that more than anything else in terms of essential, in terms of essential for survival. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is speaking about the significance of water on various things. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَأَنْزَلْنَا مِنَ السَّمَاءِ مَاءً. It is we who bring down the rain. مِنَ السَّمَاءِ مَاءً. فَأَسْكَنَّاهُ فِي الْأَرْضِ. And we give it lodging in the earth. وَإِنَّا عَلَىٰ ذَهَابٍ بِهِ لَقَادِرُونَ. And we have absolute power over withholding that water or taking that water away if we so desire. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asks you a second question. Why I'm putting these verses across? I'm going to give it to you in context. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَفَرَأَيْتُمُ الْمَاءَ الَّذِي تَشْرَبُونَ. Do you see the water that you drink? أَأَنْتُمْ أَنْزَلْتُمُوهُ مِنَ الْمُزْنِ أَمْ نَحْنُ الْمُنْزِلُونَ. Are you the one who are in control of bringing it down through the clouds? أَمْ نَحْنُ الْمُنْزِلُونَ. Or is it we who are responsible for bringing, for letting the rain and come, and the rain descend, whatever it is? لَوْ نَشَاءُ جَعَلْنَاهُ أُجَاجًا فَلَوْلَا تَشْكُرُونَ. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, if we had willed that same water, that fresh water that is available for utilization in terms of drinking water, we could have turned it into salt water. We could have turned it into salt water. أُجَاجًا فَلَوْلَا تَشْكُرُونَ. Do you not give thanks to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Now if you look at these verses, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is bringing attention to a scientific reality. Right? That 97% of the water is salt water on planet Earth. Right? The rest of the 2.5% of water, which is sweet water, right, which is available for human beings in terms of availability, in terms of, you know, rivers and water and, you know, underground water tables, etc., etc. Out of that 2.5%, 70% of that is in the polar ice caps. It's in Antarctica, it's in Greenland, and if that starts to melt, you know about the climate change and whatever it is that's taking place. Out of the 2.5%, 70% of it is gone in the polar ice caps and in Greenland and in Antarctica and so on there. And only plus minus 1% of water on planet Earth is available for human consumption. Only 1%. And the entire world is surviving on 1% of drinkable water. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَفَرَأَيْتُمُ الْمَاءَ الَّذِي تَشْرَبُونَ أَأَنْتُمْ أَنْزَلْتُمُوهُ مِنَ الْمُزْنِ أَمْ نَحْنُ الْمُنْزِلُونَ. And for your information, as much as people may talk about this and talk about that, in the history, the system of water is closed. Water is a closed system. The same amount of water has existed since the creation of earth, and when Allah wills it, if Allah wills it, it will remain the same till the day of Qiyamah. Ain't going to change. It's just the utilization of that water, right? It's just the management of that water. It's just the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how much of the water must evaporate, how much of the water must be, you know, must be lost in whatever means of possible way, which affects the usage of that water. In terms of the closed system of water, it's remained the same. Understand this reality. Now, that's my introduction, and to give you an idea of how important these dimensions of Islam are, the ecological dimension of Islam, which we are really, really even bothered about or consider in terms of our Islamic practice, in terms of our deen. And what importance is this? Now, these are not scientific facts. No, these are not scientific facts. These are realities that we have to be in connection with and in harmony with, because it gives us the ability to holistically live our lives on planet Earth and live it in accordance with the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, when we come to this one important aspect, which is the aspects of conservation which we are talking about, the Holy Prophet made a very interesting perspective. This is my approach. I'm not focusing on water only. I am focusing on all types of conservation as opposed to consumption. The Prophet made a very, very important statement in Sunan Ibn Majah. Is the Prophet said, Al-Muslimuna shuraka'u fi thalathi, that all Muslims are partners in three things. What is that? Filma, wal kula, wal nar. He said Muslims are partners in, all Muslims are partners in three things. Number one, water. Number two, herbage, you know, for vegetation and so on, for the animals to consume, etc. And for, you know, for agricultural use and agricultural land. And wal kula, wal nar, and fire. Wa thamanuhu haram. And selling these three things, water, fire, and herbage, vegetation, is haram. So let's ask our not very good friends in the Islamic State, sir, as you made everything as haram in your so-called Islamic State there, have you made the purchase of water haram? Have you provided free electricity to every citizen of the Islamic State? Because selling of electricity in modern days, you can't use fire now. It's electricity. That's what the Prophet means in terms of, is it free of charge in your country? And in terms of land for agriculture and for vegetation and for animals to consume, is that freely available? In any Islamic State, in any Islamic country, in any Muslim country, these three basic necessities for sustainable human development should essentially be free. Because the Prophet ﷺ used a very strong word. He said, haram. Wa thamanuhu haram. Selling it is haram. Haram. What does this tell us? In terms of Islamic infrastructure, that's the state, the infrastructure of an Islamic State, the first responsibility and the primary and essential responsibilities will be to ensure to create such system of management that all citizens of an Islamic country will have free and equal and beneficial access to clean, drinkable water and water for proper uses, industrial uses, agricultural uses, etc., etc., etc. Secondly, in terms of our management of our resources, in terms of granting of electricity, that is in major demand in this country. And no matter how much we try to resolve the problem by plugging the problem from the residential sector only, we're not dealing with the industrial sector that is primarily responsible, and the corporate sector out there who are consuming the most amount of electricity in our country. But the Prophet of Allah said, he said, electricity should be free. How's that? How's that? Electricity, haram, you can't sell it. It might be freely available. But Ya Rasulullah, you know how much money it takes to put up a nuclear plant? Ask South Africa. You know what? All our MPs will become paupers if it doesn't go through. How can you do this? The Prophet of Allah was bringing us to another and giving us and teaching us another dimension of Islam, which was that we must use Earth's natural resources, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has provided for us there, free of charge, in such a manner that it will benefit us and benefit others without any real cost implication. To give you an idea, the Saudis, I love using the example, the Saudis spend billions of US dollars empowering American electrical corporations and so on there to electrify the whole of Saudi Arabia. What happened to solar power? Why is it that Spain can use it? Why is it that South Africa is using it? Why is it that Germany is using it effectively? Why is it that Australia is using it effectively? And the country with the most amount of rub' al-khali is called the empty quarter. There's nothing grows there. No one inhabits the place. There's so much of desert in Arabia in general, or in the Middle East there. You have enough empty space to create enough solar power to be able to generate small populations like the Middle East and so on there. Power for the soil, and you have practically 24/7 sun. For 361 days a year, you should have sun. And you have no electric power. And the Prophet of Allah said, this should have no payment for it. Of course, only if our South African citizens were sitting in the Prophet state there. Oh God. And they said, no, we just demand it. Everything must be free. You don't pay for nothing. And take responsibility for nothing. And be accountable for nothing. Stealing it is not the same thing, sorry. Okay, please realize this. And then the Prophet said, and vegetation and herbage, agricultural land and the usage of agricultural land, right, should be equally distributed in such a way that animals can benefit from it there, because you are using the animals to consume. At the same time, the Prophet of Allah is telling you that people must have equal access to be able to produce their own food at the very least. You can discuss this entire Juma only on this hadith of the Prophet in terms of infrastructure development for Muslim countries, but we'll do that some other time. Then the Prophet said, لَا يُمْنَعُ فَضْلُ مَا يُمْنَعَ بِهِ الْكُلَىٰ. The Prophet gave another yardstick, and he gave another law, applied a certain law. He said, excess water should not be withheld so that the growth of herbage is hindered. You can't store up water at the expense of others, because water is meant to be shared. And if you have excess water through people, you know, creating their own boreholes or their own dams or whatever it is there, if that water needs to be shared, it needs to necessarily be shared. There is no option that, yes, you have a right over it because it's your own water and you build it. That's fine. But excess water in times of need in particular needs to be shared. This is something the Muslim community needs to learn. And we've been doing, mashallah, I've heard about the situation in the South Coast and so on there. Excellent work was done. Right? And I'm hoping it got enough media coverage as well. Right? An essential resource was presented to the communities out there, which was excellent. But this also brings us to another realization that in future, for Muslim communities locally and globally, I know Muslims have run into this habit. You know, we always ate our colonials, colonial masters, right? Also, Muslims have also run into the habit of creating gated estates now. If you're going in that direction, at least take something from Rasulullah. Work on creating such a model, like the way they have in Germany and I think in Australia as well, where you have enough solar power to be able to not only power your own homes, but to return it to the grid, or to return it to an internal grid system where it can feed other homes within your complex. And you include that into the costing. And if you look at it long term, you gain free electricity. The same thing with water, right? In terms of, you know, water which runs off roofs and so on there, which needs to be contained in our homes. I know in Durban and so on there, now they are expecting people who build new homes to create these, these JoJo tanks, underground tanks and so on there, for irrigation and for plants and vegetation and so on there, which they're doing because it's a necessity. But Muslims, in their homes and in their gated estates and so on, they should be working in this direction, because that's the lifestyle that you should be looking at. Everyone is looking at an eco-lifestyle now. Everything must be eco-friendly. When the Prophet of Allah said it there, we didn't want to listen. The problem with the Muslim Ummah, particularly our local community, is that, you know what, we real sheep. You know, we just ape the behavior of the rich and shameless. And not in the rich and chambers, you just ape the behavior of the colonial masters. You have to have one innovative, creative, right, white man to tell you to do things in an eco-friendly manner, and they will just market it, right? Everything must be organic, everything must be eco-friendly, everything must be biodegradable, everything must be like this, and you see all the, I'll speak about this. All our Westville ladies, all of a sudden becoming, oh, we need to recycle, we need to go organic, we need to go, but really? Really? Here's another one. Get one smart aleck, you know, who's a coconut. Sorry, my friend's got a coconut, what do you call that? Milky ones, or milky bars, or whatever it is, to start up a new trend. Right now, gardening is a very big thing. Your manicured lawn, your manicured gardens, and you know the horticulturists who came inside there, your landscape artists and so on, did your home. The next big thing, listen, hear it from me. I'm a coconut. Black on the outside, white on the inside. Hopefully the heart is white, not the rest of it. Clean, that is, inshallah. Here's a new trend. Instead of planting all your Sheena's gold, which are not even indigenous in the first place, all the way to a couple of years, that's the point, right? Create a spot in your garden, right, for vegetation, for vegetables, for lettuce, for this, for carrots, and whatever it is there. Instead of paying a dalak adam in front of all the woodies and all of the things that we bought from the research and so on there, right, use your own land. You've got plenty of land there, and right, you create a beautiful area, and you get your landscape, right, to landscape in such a way that, wow, All it needs is a little bit of, you know, sprucing up there, and the next, you know, best thing in town, right, will be all the various types of, you know, heirloom tomatoes and heirloom this and indigenous that, and, you know, homemade lettuce and, you know, just fresh from the garden. That's all we need. And we people like suckers will fall into it. But we can't be innovators. We just need to follow somebody else's name when they create it. Really, if we, in, just taking Westville as an example, if every home here, where majority of the Muslim homes have gardens, if they contributed one-fifth of their garden, right, to growing vegetables and fruit trees and whatever it is, do you know how much of fruit, vegetables will be available for people? And give it away for free. Give it away for free. Use some for yourself. You know, like we say for you know, Eid al-Adha, one third for yourself, one third for your family, one third for the poor needy. Go ahead and do it. Go ahead and do it. We talk about conservation, we talk about all these principles that Prophet of Allah spoke about it. But in terms of application there, right? Because it's just not cool enough to do it, you gotta wait somebody cool enough to think about it and innovate it before we will go ahead and do it. Really, that's our problem. Yet the Prophet of Allah was speaking about these things hundreds of years ago. Now, coming to the aspect of conservation, and this is the interesting one, that's why I was a bit late when I came. See this. I want all of you to see this. Have a good look at it. And I have the sanad, like the chain of authentic narrators who narrated this hadith of Rasulullah. It's in Sahih al-Bukhari and so on. This is an exact, or practically an exact replica of 775 mils of water, or a mud. There was Allahu Barakatuh fi mudina wa sa'ina, the Prophet said, like we have gallons and liters and so on, they would have sa' and mud. Okay? This is 775 mils of water. This was the amount of water, and I'm telling you right now, this was the amount of water that Rasulullah used to make wudu. Wait. And I can guarantee you, inshallah, that of Allah's mercy, it wasn't, he didn't utilize it completely. Because I attempted to make wudu with 250 mils of water, a sunnah wudu. A sunnah wudu. And I've done it on numerous occasions, and I've shown it to people as well. 250 mils of water, I performed a proper, inshallah, sunnah wudu three times with miswa, everything accordingly. Not one hair drop, inshallah, that I know. Uncleaned or unwashed or dry or nothing. 250 mils. So I'm saying the Prophet of Allah, this is the Prophet of Allah, when he should fill it up, he used up one mold of water. And five of these, 775 times five, 8 times, 8 by 40. 4 liters, man. Confusing me now. 4 liters, thank you. 4 liters. 4 liters of water for a bath. Five of these. 4 liters for a proper ghusl. Now comes the question of sunnah. Difficult sunnah. Very difficult sunnah in terms of application. 4 liters? I think we end up using 4 liters before, you know, when we open the tapestry to get the tap warm. We end up using 4 liters. The Prophet of Allah would have a sunnah ghusl with 4 liters of water. In fact, less than that. That's it. That's it. I haven't tried that one yet, but I do have a problem. But you may remember those days when you had the little bucket, and then you had a bucket bath. Not very long time ago, Imam al-Ghazali, rahimahullah, he mentioned that he said people should not bath with water running, our modern day showers. They shouldn't be bathing like that. Keep the water in a bucket, right? And utilize that water effectively and sparingly. But this Islam we don't want to live, because this Islam is inconvenient, because it hides an inconvenient truth for us as to how essentially wasteful we are. Just one example. I haven't even started my discussion yet. Just to give you an idea, right? In terms of how we go forward, Muslims have been very well known, you know, in terms of donating boreholes and everything for areas for the benefit of the general community and so on. We need to go one step beyond laws. We need to work towards some long-term project in terms of the preservation and conservation of essential resources, whether it is through the electrification project, whether it's through the water project, and so on, for greater sustainability. It's something that a Muslim should, and it's not something that, the first thing, how much is it going to cost? We don't need to show a cost. I gave you one example of homes nowadays, of gated estates, and whatever it is. I gave you the example of creating a little vegetable patch in your home for free use of anybody. You know, I remember my great-great-grandfather, right? We had mango orchards here. For those of you who lived here for, or have been here for a long time, we had plenty of mango trees. In fact, we had a guava tree. Allah have mercy on the guava tree. What a beautiful guava tree we have carried down, right? Beautiful guavas. Mango trees galore. We used to actually take the mangoes and put them in a wheelbarrow, and we used to leave it outside because this used to be the main road going towards Peter Mansberg at that time. And it should be a big sign there, free fruit and mangoes for anybody to take. No question asked, take as much as you want. The same thing with drought. In 1983, by the way, if you didn't know, if you go walk outside the Masjid, you know where the seats and the concrete seats with the little arches underneath there, you'll come to one point there towards the center where you can see like a silvery piece. You know, it's like almost like a, to create a tap, I don't know what they call, like a resaint of the thing there. It's still there. That marks the spot where the well is to be found. In 1983, when there was drought, if you remember 1983, my father opened up the well. And we were distributing free water to people in 1983. And free water used to be given for travelers, which was the tradition of the Arabs anyway. For those days, you know, people used to go there, should keep water available there. Free usage of water, please utilize the water. And this is Arab tradition. You don't have to ask people in the desert for water. You have the right to water. It's a given. These are the things that the Muslim Ummah needs to work with and work towards in terms of the next 5, 10, 20 years. These are the goals that we should be working, because we need to start preparing not only for ourselves, but for the challenges of the new generation, and preparing our children for the challenges that you and I may not be seeing, but they will be faced with it. And if we lay the solid foundations for these things today, right, the Muslim Ummah will benefit at a later stage. Thirdly, in terms of difficulty, whether it's drought, whether it's famine, whether it's, you know, the certain things are not available on the market, we need to follow the Uthmani tradition, the Uthmani Sunnah, to give you an idea. When there was shortage of water in Medina, when people came to Medina, they realized that Medina was selling water, and the Jews had the monopoly over the water in Medina, and people were having difficulty with the man was charging exorbitant prices. So Sayyidina Uthman al-Ghani radiallahu ta'ala anhu used to invest in wisely. He should invest with God. مَنْ بَلَّذِي يُخْرِجُ اللَّهَ قَرْضًا حَسَنًا وَيُضَاعِفَهُ لَهُ أَضْعَافًا كَثِيرًا. He used to invest with Allah. So what he did was, he went there to the Jewish man, he said, come, I'll go to partnership with you. The guy refused to sell the mission. I'll go to partnership with you. How much do you want? He asked for an exorbitant price. 20,000 dirhams. Way, way above the asking price. 20,000. Sayyidina Uthman al-Ghani said, done. So far, any business will tell you, why am I paying, 500% more than what it's done? No problem, done. Fair partners. One day yours, one day mine. No problem. The day that the Jew was selling the water, people came and bought. The next day, salesman, and then he said, free water, take it. Free water, take it. No questions asked, take the water. The next day, the Jew came and no one said, give my water. The next day, Usman al-Ghani radiallahu ta'ala came and said, free water, take it. 50-50 partners. Take the water. One day is mine, one day is yours. Take it. Eventually, the guy realized he's going to lose. He doesn't say, okay, just take the water, get it over. He paid him off and got it over. Second example, there was a time of famine where in certain basic essentials, like, you know, you and I have flour, wheat, rice, or whatever it was, it was in possibly, you know, it was very, very, had come down very scarce. That's it. Usman al-Ghani radiallahu ta'ala anhu goes out. He had already predicted there would be a shortage. So he went out there and he bought all the crop from all the farmers. Now, the businessmen in the area decided, well, we know there's going to be a shortage there. It's a time for us to make money, like you and I think nowadays as well. Right? We bought the goods 6 months ago. We're sitting within our stock room. Once there's a shortage there, put the price up. That's when we make money. But the Uthmani way of thinking is different. He does business and he gets his maximum amount of profit from Allah. he sold his goods to Allah. So he bought it off. When the people, when the middleman, right, and other merchants went from Medina to go and purchase all the, you know, the goods, then all the farmers were already sold. Everybody bought everything. Who bought everything off? Come on, tell us. He said, no, I'm not allowed to tell you. Tell us, and eventually he said, Osman ahead. All the merchants come to Osman ahead. He said, yeah, Osman, what are you doing? You're going to kill the market. You're going to kill the market. We wanted to make a killing here. You're killing the market. What's wrong? Come on, we'll pay you 5 times, 10 times the amount. But though he says no, I've already, someone has given me a better price. Who could this be who gave you a better price for it? Come on, tell us. And I said, I sold it to Allah. I sold it to Allah. And when it hit, Osman al-Ghani radiallahu ta'ala then distributed that basic commodity free of charge. No cost. I paid for it. I sold it to Allah. My profit is with Allah. That type of what they call in this day a social corporate responsibility from an Islamic perspective, right, needs to be nurtured in our community. Really, we don't have it. Right? The number of times I've heard people say, hey, but this one is mocking us and saying it about us. Also, at the same time, we need to come to realize that internationally what happens affects poor country. Although we wish, and you know, we hope to be like first world country, we still a third world country, so forget about it. But realize that what happens internationally affects us as well. Just to give you an idea, in terms of consumption, America, in terms of energy consumption only, America is 4.5% of the world's population. Yet it consumes 20% of the world's resources. You think in terms of consumption, India, with its large population, would be consuming more. Let me give you an idea how bad things are. If an Indian family, husband and wife, with seven children, don't compare to the consumption of an American person, right, with one member in the family. Meaning, husband and wife and one child, in terms of the consumption of one husband, one wife, one child in America, one husband, one child, and seven children in India, don't compare to that one family. In fact, if they wanted to compare the Indians, they would have had to have 17 children to consume the amount of energy a husband and a wife and a child consume in America. Just to give you an idea. And in terms of basic commodities that you and I consume, rice. God help the rice, distributors and so on. To produce 1 kilo of rice requires 5,000 liters of water. 1 kilo. 1 kilo of rice requires 5,000 liters to produce. We need to rethink our basic commodities as well. Right? There's various ways of consumption and conservation. But we need to find the balance because we are the Ummah of Muhammed. It's our responsibility. We should be championing these causes. We have plenty of causes to champion as opposed to, you know, just using ships, hands and all to blow up stuff and whatever it is. We have better work than that. And one more option, I think before we create water rationing and everything for the consumer and so on, my suggestion to the South African government, and I'm not going to laugh and chuckle when I say these things, right, is that for 1 month, stop the production of all soft drinks and fruit juices. It will do the whole community a great deal of good and improve the health of the community as well. There's one option. Umar, you may have enough.
We are the Muslim Ummah.
Alhamdulillah, 1 in 5 people in the world is a Muslim. But have we considered that 4 out of 5 people may die without Islam? 4 out of 5 may never get the chance to read the glorious Holy Quran. Become a lifetime partner with the Islamic Propagation Center International Dawah Quran Project and help bring real solutions to the 4 out of 5 people searching for answers. By sponsoring a Holy Quran, you give the gift of life, real life. IPCI, Dawah Quran Project. It's time to get involved.
Call IPCI now. IPCI, encircling the globe with the message of Islam.